Another theoretical approach is the bottom-up approach, where we look at individual clouds and the take the microphysics more into focus and then try to conclude on the global properties. So let's look at which parts of a galaxy's interstellar medium are eligible to form stars and what star formation rate for individual clouds result. So which gas is star forming? From observations, we find that stars form in molecular gas. That's where the that's the denser gas. Where is the molecular gas in a galaxy? So that's the first thing we have to answer. And we have to find physical explanations why this molecular gas seems to form stars more efficiently. So maybe it's because H2 and CO are cooling more efficiently. So first of all, H2 is cooling very inefficiently, and CO is cooling very efficiently, but this can't be the reason, because even C+, that occurs where CO has not yet formed, is very good in cooling the gas. So we don't need the very dense molecular gas. We can stay in the atomic gas where we have a lot of C+ and still sufficiently cool the clouds to actually form higher masses before they come unstable. Instead, it turns out that H2 is associated with the star formation because of shielding. Let's look at the thermal balance in this interstellar medium to understand this point a little bit deeper. The main heating in the interstellar medium is mostly due to photoelectric heating and cosmic ray heating. So here the point is when we have dust grains and they are hit by a UV photon, an electron is kicked away from the electron gas in the solid body here and gets sufficient energy to eject the dust particle, and it then collides with many gas atoms, and each collision transports a fraction of the kinetic energy to the gas, so this is a heating process. We can also heat by cosmic rays, so that depends a little bit on which volume we are in. The total heating rate is just a function of the UV flux, so we need UV photons, metallicity term, then an attenuation term due to the optical depth, and some rate. And the cosmic ray ionization rate is more or less a constant because it's not significantly attenuated within common column density, so it just passes through the whole cloud. If CO has not yet formed, C+ is the main coolant, so all the carbon gas is basically in form of C+, and this emits radiation at 158 micrometer, or 1900 gigahertz. The energy level, this is a two-level system, fine structure line. The upper level corresponds to 92 Kelvin excitation energy. And if the gas is optically thin and we have LTE, we can write down the cooling rate just as the excitation rate times an abundance times the energy per process times the density. So this gives us the total energy that's been emitted by one carbon particle, and when we multiply this then with this delta, which relates the hydrogen density with the carbon abundance, we get the total cooling. So all the energy radiated away, and under balance we have a heating equals cooling, and this establishes a temperature that we can determine by rearranging our equilibrium. So that depends on the temperature of the upper level, which is 92 Kelvin, doesn't matter, the density and the fluxes. When we look at the two cases that FUV dominates, so we have FUV heating, we can determine the temperature that is established in the ISM, which is just a function of the UV intensity, the density, and the optical depth. And if we have cosmic ray dominating, then we have here just the cosmic ray ionization rate and the metallicity as a factor in the denominator. So then the transition between these two regimes is at tau at about 3. So when we are at a tau of 3, UV photons cannot penetrate deeper into the cloud, but cosmic rays can, and so they start to take over in the energy balance. When we look at this and assume that this here, this is about 0, this logarithmic factor, then this results automatically in a temperature of about 23 Kelvin. So even though we have no CO but R and have C plus, then we still have significant lower thermal temperatures compared to the excitation temperature. So the gas can be cool even though we have no CO. When we are in the FUV-dominated regime and at low optical depth, then we find temperatures in the order of 100K. And we already learned that when we have the temperature and the densities, we can figure out the genes masses, so that's the mass over which a volume of gas turns gravitational unstable. Here's again the formula. So at 100 Kelvin and a density of 100 particles per cubic centimeter, this is about 5,000 solar masses. Changing the temperature, depending on whether we have something like 90 or 20 Kelvin temperature, makes a difference of factor 8 in the genes mass. So at high values of the optical depth, that prohibits any further ultraviolet heating, this lowers the mass that is stable against collapse, so smaller volumes can now become gravitational unstable. So the idea of these bottom-up models is that the change in the genes mass as a function of tau regulates the star formation. So it determines the tau at which the clouds become internally unstable. If the gas is warm, because we have FUV heating, it is too warm to become unstable, so it's thermally stabilized, and in cold regions the star formation proceeds efficiently. We can look, for example, at the results of numerical simulations. This is shown here on the left-hand side, where for every position in our numerical simulation, we know the temperature because we compute it and we can do statistics over this. This is done here on the left-hand side. We know also the density and we can draw the density and the temperature of every single volume element in this diagram. And here, for the different diagrams, we change the physics that is activated in our model. So, for example, we have no optical depth, we have no shielding of UV radiation, therefore all the gas is very hot because UV can reach all the gas. When we activate the shielding and distinguish between molecular gas and have CO, then you see that at a certain density we have low temperatures while at lower densities we have, statistically speaking, most of the gas at much higher temperatures. And this regulates basically what volume, for example, this volume here, is then star forming. UV radiation destroys H2. However, every dissociation process also destroys one dissociating photon. So the hydrogen forms the deeper lying hydrogen molecules from destructive radiation. This is called shielding, and we can compute the column density of hydrogen that is necessary to be destroyed before all the UV photons are used up. And this is given here with this expression. And we can convert this also in our surface quantities and then find here this quantity. We can correspond this to an optical depth at which the gas becomes molecular, at which the transition from the atomic to molecular hydrogen takes place. This is a function of the intensity of the UV field, the densities, and the metallicities. Higher density reduces the optical depth at which this takes place. So the transition is closer to the surface of the cloud when the gas is dense. Higher UV fluxes push the transition further in. And just roughly, this is about the same optical depth at which the transition from UV to cosmic rays dominated heating occurs. So this factor here, sigma times the inverse density, is about constant in the Milky Way because we have an equilibrium between the ionized and the cold gas. And this is a nice physical explanation why the star formation is correlated to molecular gas in terms of shielding of the gas that allows then the gas to be cool enough, which lowers the mass that is becoming unstable, and so we can form stars. It gives a physical reason for the breakdown at smaller surface densities, because then we just don't have sufficient column depth. And the metallicity dependence is also explained because the metallicity alters the shielding capabilities of the gas. So here in this relationship, we plot the star formation rate again against the total gas surface densities. And these are two different theoretical lines here in black and in green for different metallicities. So one is solar, 0.2 is very subsolar. And we see how this differs then in terms of the star formation rate. When we look at the overall star formation rate, why does this then, or does this explain why we observe a pretty low star formation rate? One possibility to reduce the star formation efficiency is possible turbulent support. So when we look at turbulent medium, we saw the Larsen relation. So we find a line width size relation. Larger clouds have a higher population of more faster moving particles. And this defines a sonic length that corresponds to what parts of this flow will be able to become genes unstable. And the maximum mass that can be held up against turbulence, we saw this in the stability section, is the Bonnet-Ebert mass, which is a function of this gene's length and the density. The corresponding radius of these spherical objects is about 40% of a gene's length. when we write down our virial terms, so the gravitational energy, the thermal energy, and the turbulent energy, then we find that the stability is collapsing. So the collapsing parts of the flow are there where the density is very high, because higher density decreases the kinetic energy. We find that the potential energy is larger than the turbulence, and the Jeans length is smaller than the sonic length. So we collapse when we have a Jeans length smaller than the sonic length. The Jeans length can be written like this. And we can make this ansatz here for the general Jeans length as a function of density. And for this criterion to hold, we need to have an x larger than a critical x, which can be given as this term. And from this, we can compute the mass fraction where this is the case. And this is here then our expression. We integrate over the Gaussian, which gives the error function. And when we assume a certain fraction f that collapses every freefall time, we then get the star formation rate per freefall time as this result here times our star form, our freefall time. And we find this here from observations. We find an virial ratio that can be described, that can be written here in terms of the radius and the velocity dispersions. Then our line width size relation can be written like this, and this gives us a sonic length as this term here. Writing this all together, this gives us a critical density. Again, x was here the density ratio. Let's move up here. The ratio between the scales, so not the density, but the scales. And this can be written in units of the virial ratio and the Mach number. So for a virial ratio of 2, our free fall efficiency is 0.1. Recall that we observed something like 0.01. So we are about 10 orders of magnitude away. But when we add some additional local feedback that decreases epsilon further, then we are moving in the right direction and get about the correct orders of magnitude. The strengths of the bottom-up model is that it reproduces the dependence of the star formation rate with the interstellar medium phases. It explains the metallicity dependence, and it produces about the correct efficiencies for our star formation. However, this transition from 0.1 to 0.01 is somewhat a qualitative explanation and not yet fully explained. And we have no inclusion of any global regulation of the interstellar medium and its hydrobalance. This is not part of the model, so we don't know where any initial hydrostatic balance comes from. So again, we see some observations can be observed and others remain unobserved. So this is one of the reasons why star formation is one of the active research fields in astrophysics.